Judge, I'm going to object. What seems here is that he's using someone else's report to try to impeach him with his prior inconsistent statement.
I think the threat of questioning is what documentation, apparently the only documentation as of this John Small incident is what is being referenced by Mr. Gilmore in S37, and to the extent that, unfortunately, Mr. Saunders' report cannot be ascertained, can't be accessed, that there is no record of whatever it is that Mr. Saunders says he allegedly did. There's no record of that in any report that exists at this point. And there's some argument at some point that Mr. Gilmore may want to make about that.
Judge, this report written by some other officer should not bear upon the credibility of this witness, of the defendant. Shouldn't bear upon his credibility. They're using it as a prior inconsistent statement, but it's not the defendant's statement.
Well, the issue is, I think what has been set out either by regulations or otherwise in some of the testimony is, what are the responsibilities of an officer? Are they supposed to write a report? Are they supposed to document anything that they've done? So the thrust of the argument and for the jury to determine is, did that happen? And if there's no record, arguably, in parentheses, if there's no record of Mr. Saunders' involvement in an incident that he says he was involved in some capacity, clearing the room, putting him against the wall, whatever the case may be, that casts some question about whether he was involved. And I think that's an argument for you and Mr. Gilmore to talk about in your respective positions at the appropriate time, either through questioning, recross, redirect, whatever the case may be, but that seems, from the court's standpoint, to be the context in which this line of question is geared. And I think it's a fair line of question for reasons I think.
Thank you.
So Sergeant Norton was the supervisor, sort of the main officer that ties everything together, is that fair to say?
Yeah.
Right, and didn't Sergeant Norton list several involved staff in his report?
Yes.
And actually there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 names that are listed. His name is not listed as one of the involved staff, is it?
No.
Even though this is one of your units. And you were there?
Yes.
One of two officers that was there?
Yes.
And you also, again, talking about the contraband that you learned about in the women's bathroom, you didn't write a report about that, did you?
No.
And talking a little about McCovey and Shepherd and just generally the inmates on the unit, a lot of the inmates on your unit would come in the sergeant's office with you, you said. Is that right?
No, I didn't say that. I didn't usually come in the sergeant's office.
I think you said 99 out of 100 inmates.
I said 99. I'm saying we come talk to
them. In the sergeant's office?
The sergeant's office. We just come talk to
them. I thought you had said earlier that was in the sergeant's office. So was Lacovian then the only inmate that you would talk to in the sergeant's office?
No.
You talked to Lacovian a lot, though, didn't you?
He was my head coach, and he was the
as far as inmates go, he's kind of the guy in the unit, right?
If you want to call him that.
Well, he said he was like the second guy there for you. Sounds like that's pretty much what you're saying. Other than the COs, he's the guy. Is that fair to say?
If you want to call him that.
And you interacted with him a lot, right? Because of that. He's a new rep, he's a cook.
And an active with him.
Right, and you know that when he gave his statement to the police that he had no plea agreement at that time. You know that, don't you?
Not yet.
Objection, Judge.
Well, he just said he knew it and he said, no, I didn't know.
Well, did you review the discovery? I thought you said earlier
that you reviewed the discovery.
And you told your attorney on direct several times that you read the discovery, didn't you?
Yes, I'll read the discovery.
Well, the discovery includes the statements that Cogan Shepard made, doesn't it?
Yes.
And it also includes his plea agreement, doesn't it? surprise you to know that he pled after that statement? So, essentially, Lacovey and Shepard made a statement where he said, and we heard it in court as well, that you brought him tobacco and drugs. Isn't that right?
Yeah, he said that.
Right, and by saying that, he subjected himself to criminal charges.
Objection, Judge.
The objection is
improper. My question, Judge.
I think that it seems to be it seems to be whether or not Mr. Saunders' interactions with Lacovey and Shepard were, I guess, well, not his interactions. Whether or not Mr. Saunders would know why Mr. Shepard testified the way he did at a particular time, be it pre-plea agreement, post-plea agreement, and again, said before, if Mr. Saunders does not know the answer to a question, and Mr. Saunders, I should have said this down, said it to other witnesses, acceptable answers, as far as the court is concerned, are, I know the answer to a question, I can give the answer, I do not know the answer to a question, maybe something that I just don't know, I can't get inside someone's head, whatever the case may be, or you may not understand the question and it can be rephrased. So, if there's ever a question that gets asked that seems to be along the lines of something that's beyond what you would know from your own personal involvement in this case, if you will, you can certainly say, I can't answer the question. And that would be an acceptable answer.
Thank you, Your Honor. And I think you had testified earlier that you thought the reason why Kobe and John Small would say you're responsible for getting them drugs is that the inmates didn't like you. Is that what you said? When you were asked on direct by Mr. Thompson why Kobe would testify that you bought him drugs and tobacco?
Yeah, those two didn't like me.
Your testimony was that the inmates didn't like you, wasn't it? Or people don't like you?
We was talking about as far as officers there.
My memory was that you were saying that for everybody.
Well, officers, other inmates, whatever. Officer, inmates, whatever. Like I said, I can't sit up here and decide, you know, who likes me, who don't like me.
So Lacovian then made up a crime where you were passing him contraband in exchange for money because he doesn't like you?
I have no idea. Now, why he said what he said.
Didn't he say it because it's true, because you were passing Lacovian tobacco and drugs?
I was not passing Lacovian no tobacco or drugs.
Now, you said that despite 503 phone calls with Tasha Swain, taking her to lunch, flirting with her, learning about her daughter, that you never found out from her that Lacovian was her husband, right? Did you testify?
Yes.
Now, Lacovian is on your unit. He's sort of the guy among the inmates. He's the rep. He's the cook. You never found out that he has a girlfriend on the outside?
I never asked.
You never asked him. All of your conversations with him, it never came up that the girl that you were meeting and you were calling 503 times was Lacovian's wife.
I don't ask no inmate no personal information about him. No inmate.
Now, when the major testified, Major O'Hara, she was asked about a video of Unit 6. Do you remember that?
Yes.
Okay. During the interview with the detectives, weren't you also shown the video yourself on Unit 6?
No, he didn't show me the video.
Did they talk to you about an incident where you were going to the sergeant's office with inmates?
Yes, they talked to me about it.
Isn't that the same video that you saw?
I had no idea. Video.
Wasn't there an issue with you going to the sergeant's office that was discussed during that interview with the detectives?
Yes.
When you were on the unit, you wore your vest under your shirt then?
Yes.
And because of that, you knew that you were going to have to take off your vest when you entered the prison. Yeah. Not as a matter of course, right?
Yes.
You wouldn't, only if there was a problem would you have to take off the vest, right?
Yes.
And you knew, when you saw Terry O'Hara, Major O'Hara testify that the only way that a guard would have to take off the vest is if they failed a metal detector three times. You heard that testimony, right?
Yeah.
Did you ever have to take off your vest?
No.
Did Tasha Swain know that you were a guard, that it was your job to be a corrections officer?
You see the person?
Did Tasha Swain, did you tell, or didn't you tell Tasha Swain that your job was being a corrections officer?
Yes.
So, again, she knew you were a corrections officer, her husband was in prison, and it never came up that her husband was in prison.
She never said anything about as far as my job. The only thing she asked was, who do you do? I said, I'm a corrections officer.
You said she told you that her brother or her cousin, if you said both, was an inmate at Southwoods.
Yeah, she said. She said her brother down at Southwoods State Prison.
Well, doesn't that seem a little bit relevant to your job?
Objection.
You're a corrections officer.
That's
you're a corrections officer. She has a brother in prison. It doesn't seem to you to be relevant to your job.
And a whole other person. I don't know inmates at Southern, just like if I don't know inmates at Northern.
Well, Southern State and Southwoods are pretty close to each other, aren't they? They're two of the closest prisons in the correctional system, aren't they?
No, that would be
Bayside and Southern State.
Southern State.
Right. And inmates like McCook and Shepherd got transferred from Southern State to Southwoods, didn't he?
Yes.
He did, didn't he?
Yeah, done that personal knowledge of it.
Testified to.
What, do you remember at some point, was that after?
Yeah, it was afterwards, Judge.
Oh, he was transferred after, was there?
If the question is whether he remembers the hearing, that's okay with that.
Okay.
Right. Didn't Lacovia testify that after this happened, he went to Southwoods?
Yes.
And when you saw Tamara Hudson testify, right?
Yes.
When she testified, she said that the money that she gave you was so you could go on vacation, right?
Yes.
Because she came into a lot of money, right?
Yes.
So she wanted to give you some.
Yes.
And you said $1,000? She said $1,000 also, right?
Yes.
Do you remember when you were interviewed that you told the detective that she actually gave the money for a broken window? Well, which is it?
She gave me $1,000 for, it was for my vacation and for a broken windshield.
Why didn't she testify when she was on the stand that it was also for a broken windshield?
She didn't know it was for a broken windshield.
Okay. So in your mind, again, it was for a broken windshield and a vacation?
No. In the text message that I sent to the other officer, that's what I told her. $1,000.
Well, is that true that that was for that, or you just sent it to another officer just because?
No, that's actually true.
But Tamara doesn't know that.
Tamara just gave me $1,000.
She testified when she was here that was for your vacation.
Yes, she testified that it was for my vacation. She just gave me $1,000.
And your brother needed to give you money for this vacation also?
I asked him.
Why does everybody need to give you money for your vacation?
I asked my brother. I was unaware to where it was going to be. I asked my brother. He gave me the money.
So people need to fund your vacation, yet you're able to loan money out to people at the same time.
People do not need to fund my vacation. I asked my brother. He gave me money.
You asked your brother, who was specifically not invited to the vacation, to give you money for the vacation.
Gave me too.
And you never told the detectives in 2 hours about that.
All the detective asked me was, she said she gave you $1,000.
I didn't ask you, though, what the detective asked you. What I said was, you didn't tell the detectives that your brother gave you money.
And I said again, I answered the question the detective asked me.
Well, during that interview, you didn't appear to have any problem asking the detective's questions or taking over the interview. You had ample opportunity in 2 hours to bring up your brother, didn't you?
And they could ask me any question. You, like you say, I said to answer questions. They could ask me a question they want to ask me. The question they asked me, I answered the questions that they asked me.
Right. The question you couldn't answer, though, was why would you take money from Tasha Swain to bring drugs into the prison? Right? You couldn't answer that question.
Because I never brought drugs into the prison.
But you told the officers you were thinking about it when you were interviewed, didn't you?
Due to the conversation I had with Detective Engelhardt, for me to cooperate, so you can make sure that you go home.
So, in 10 years of being a corrections officer, going through the academy, learning how to patrol, doing the functions of a corrections officer, somehow in your mind you decided it was better to make up crimes that you committed than to just not say anything about.
I sat here, talked to Detective Ingram, came in while I was in the holding cell, made a conversation with me about, listen, one suggestion, this is what we should do so you can go home.
You knew that he wasn't going to take you into custody when you were done with that interview, didn't you? You knew that he wasn't going to put you in a cell after the interview, didn't you?
No, I didn't.
You knew you were going to get sent home on a summons, didn't you?
No, I didn't.
Well, you heard that Tasha Swain didn't say anything. Same charges as you, and she got sent home on a summons.
No, during the interview, I didn't know Tasha Swain.
But you knew that she got arrested. Didn't they tell you that she got arrested?
No. They said that they talked to Tasha. They did not say that they arrested her or they brought her here. But they said they talked to Tasha.
So, essentially your testimony today is that you made up that you're guilty of a crime during that interview.
Judge, I'm going to object to the characterization. He said he answered questions that were asked, not he implicated himself in crime.
Well, he said he didn't tell the truth.
But that's not implicating himself in crime. He asked specific questions, Judge. I would suggest that it was rephrased. It might relieve the problem.
We could have the question.